1440 WNYG Babylon.
Welcome back. This is Chris Sarnes and your host of Iron Sharpens Iron. If you just tuned us in, our theme today is revealing the identity of the Beast of Revelation and the Antichrist, so at least in the eschatological and theological position of our guest, Gary DeMar, who is an author. He's a Christian apologist, the president of American Vision, and editor-in-chief of Biblical World View magazine. And it's such a great pleasure to have you back on the program, Gary DeMar.
Well, thanks for having me back. I appreciate it, especially on a topic like this, what oftentimes gets some listeners rather riled up.
Yes, people do hold to their traditions very passionately when it comes to these issues. It seems eschatology reigns supreme with a lot of folks, and if you mess with their views of the end times, you better watch out. But we are going to be revealing today your view or your position on who is the Beast of Revelation and the Antichrist. And I promise all of you listening, there will be no jokes made to any particular candidate running for president of the United States right now. But
By the way, Chris, I did hear from somebody that this is no joke, that they thought it was Barack Obama. And because I've been teaching a class on Daniel in our church, and this woman teaches with her, and anyway, she came up and said that she thought it was Barack Obama. She gave these various reasons, and this person was in my class said, "Well, do you know that the Bible doesn't say this, 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 and this?" And this woman was kind of in shock. So, somebody's going around with Barack Obama as the Antichrist, very much like they went around saying Ronald Reagan was the Antichrist. Yep. Because his name is Ronald Wilson Reagan. Each of the three names registers the number six. Six letters in each name, so it's not beyond the realm of possibility that you'll find all kinds of people out there who are going to identify each of the candidates as the Antichrist.
Yes, in fact, I think Don Imus said it was Hillary Clinton. and of course, we also want to address other things such as the Whore of Babylon, the Man of Perdition, the False Prophet, other terms like that that are used in Scripture. But and this all. By the way, for those of you listening, is a part of the subject matter in Gary DeMar's book, Last Days Madness. We began our discussion several weeks ago with Gary on his book, Last Days Madness, but we were primarily, during that interview, focusing on what Gary believes are the errors of dispensationalist eschatology, and today we wanted to focus on what Gary actually believes himself. So why don't we just cut to the chase. Who is or who was the Beast of Revelation and the Antichrist?
Well, again, any time I deal with a subject like this, and this is something every Christian ought to do, is you need to go to the Scriptures themselves to let the Bible itself define our terms for us. And too often many Christians hear things from people from so-called Bible experts, and they've never really checked out the Bible itself on this topic. And so I always ask a Christian, well, what is the biblical definition of Antichrist? And to be honest, Chris, I find blank stares from people. They've never really thought about it before. Mm-hmm. They'll take the word and says, well, Antichrist, it means somebody who's against Christ. And of course, that is the most basic definition of Antichrist, but it isn't particular enough.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible tells us in what way a person mm-hmm. is an Antichrist. And so if you go to 2 John verse 7, the word Antichrist, for example, which is kind of a curiosity, does not appear anywhere in the book of Revelation, which you would think that's where it would appear the most. The word isn't found there at all. It's only found in John's epistles. Paul doesn't use it, none of the other New Testament writers use it. Only John does in his first and second epistle. And if you look at the definition in verse 7 of 2 John. It says, "For many deceivers have gone out into the world. Those who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh, this is the deceiver and the Antichrist."
Mm-hmm.
So there are a couple of things in this passage that you learn. The fact that there are many of them, there's not just one,
mm-hmm.
and that they were, in fact, alive and well in John's day, And then the other is definitionally, they are the ones who deny that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. And so instead of this being a political figure, I believe that it's very clear here that John is describing somebody of a religious figure. Rome didn't care whether or not Jesus was the Messiah or not. They cared whether he was a king, and claiming to be a king, that was the argument that was used in the gospel accounts of how some of the Jews wanted to get rid of Jesus. There were two trials, one Herod, one Pilate, and with Pilate, he declares himself to be a king. So Rome didn't care whether Jesus was the Messiah. They cared whether or not he was a king. And then in 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, John writes, "Children, it is the last hour, and just as you heard that Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have arisen. From this we know that it is the last hour." And then verse 23, "Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father. The one who confesses the Son has the Father also. And this is the liar, but the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ, this is the Antichrist, the one who denies the Father and the Son." So this is obviously a theological figure, probably the apostate Jews who denied that Jesus was the Messiah, that he was the Son of God, that he was God in human flesh, and they were the Judaizers, or those were the ones who were attacking the Jewish church in the first century. This is not a political figure.
So are the Westminster Catechism and the London Baptist Confession of Faith incorrect when they declare that the Pope is the Antichrist?
Well, that is a popular view, and you're right. Almost all the reformers identified the Antichrist as related to the papacy. I believe that this is where they got it right. They got it right that it was a religious figure, not a political figure. But like so much of prophetic speculation, there are those who tend to interpret the Bible in terms of their own cultural situation, their own political situation, or whatever's going on in the church right now. I think it's very clear from John that whoever these antichrists were, they were alive and well in his day. And while you might be able to make some application to the papacy, I don't think that's what Paul, I don't think that's what John had in mind.
Do you think you could apply that to any heretical group that denies that Jesus came in the flesh, such as Gnostics?
Probably, but again, the first thing we have to do is determine what John was probably referring to. Now, it's possible, because you get into the book of Revelation, there he talks about this in the Nicolaitans, and it's some believe that they were the Gnostics. But I think John was dealing here with those in the Jewish community who denied that Jesus was in fact related to the Father in any way, and who denied that he was in fact the promised Messiah. I think that's really going on here. The confessions, of course, the Westminster Confession of Faith, at least in the Presbyterian Church in America, and I'm not sure if it's in the Orthodox Presbyterian Church. They have changed the Westminster Confession of Faith on the identity of the Antichrist. They no longer, the revision of the Westminster Confession of Faith no longer holds that the papacy is the Antichrist.
Yes, and I know that many, if not most, Reformed Baptists who hold to the 1689 London Baptist Confession, which is nearly identical to the Westminster, leave that up for personal interpretation.
Yeah.
They don't make that as an essential element of the confession.
Right. But it's still a view that's held today, so mm-hmm. It's more in, for those of your listeners who understand this, the historicist perspective of interpreting Revelation, that's generally that the papacy is considered to be the Antichrist.
And it's no wonder why the Reformers thought so in a day and age when tens of thousands of evangelicals were being tortured and murdered for their faith.
Oh yeah, I mean the doctrines of the Pope setting himself up as the vicar of Christ, the representative of Christ on earth, the trappings of the Roman Catholic Church, the vestments and the garments and the ceremonies and so forth. One could understand that was indeed the case. But again, I would say that this is that's more of an applicational way of looking at the Antichrist definition than the actual historical interpretation of the of what John was getting at.
Mm-hmm. Now, unlike the term Antichrist, which the scriptures clearly teach is not one individual, there is a different scenario with the beast of Revelation, correct?
Yeah, there are actually, if you go to Revelation chapter 13, there are actually two beasts mentioned. There is a beast coming up out of the sea in Revelation 13:1, and then there is a beast that comes up out of the earth in Revelation 13:11. So there are actually two beasts, and for this you really, you have to have some idea of Daniel's prophecy, because there you see these beasts, the leopard, the bear, the lion, and so forth, although there's the dragon here as well. This is these are obviously political entities to a certain extent, because beasts generally in the Old Testament referred to, was Babylon and the Medes and the Persians and Greece and then Rome. Many speculate that the sea beast here is a reference to Rome, because it comes up out of this comes up out of the sea, which would make it a Gentile nation, and then the beast that comes up out of the land, and who has two horns like a lamb and speaks as a dragon, is probably apostate Israel colluding with Rome in the first century against the church, or colluding with Nero in one sense against the church. So you got two beasts, one land, one sea. Sea beast probably Rome, land beast probably first century Israel.
Now, what do you make of the view that it was Nero?
Well, the way that is worked out, and a lot of this has to do with the dating of Revelation. If the book of Revelation was written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in A.D. 70, it makes Nero as a candidate for the sea beast a probable, and the if it's written after the destruction of Jerusalem in A.D. 70, then that's anybody's guess. I believe that the book of Revelation was written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in A.D. 70, and so Nero seems to be the best candidate here, because we learn from Revelation that the sixth king, the sixth Caesar, as the interpretation goes, was alive while Revelation was imparted to John. The early date for the book of Revelation is certainly prominent in the book of Revelation itself, because we find that John is told to measure the temple, and we know the temple was destroyed in A.D. 70, and that's one of the indicators that the book of Revelation was written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in A.D. 70.
Yes, my friend Dan Bonifico, president of the Historical Bible Society, who agrees with you on the early dating of Revelation, he says that one of the evidences, one of the strongest evidences that it was written prior to AD 70 is because the scriptures do not actually record the destruction of the temple within its pages.
Yeah, that is one of the arguments. You know, they argue and they say, well, here you got the book of Revelation written around AD 95 during the reign of Domitian. Certainly some of the authors of the New Testament would have said something about the destruction of Jerusalem. That is an argument, but it's more an argument, you know, from silence. There's no way to prove that. Some might say, well, it was 25 years after the fall of Jerusalem and so forth, but that is an argument, you know, that has been made. And Chris, what's been interesting is the amount of scholarship that's coming out on the early date of Revelation, as well as people, I mean, you got John Ankerberg, who's a dispensationalist, basically saying that it's probable that all the New Testament books were written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Josh McDowell makes the same claim, and it's coming from secular and Christian sources that it's almost without a doubt that all of the New Testament books were written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Liberals tended to date the New Testament books late. When you date a book early, you're really taking the more conservative position over against liberals. Not that people who dated in AD 95 are liberals, but it is the tendency of liberals to date the books of the New Testament as late as possible, even into the second century.
Yes, well, it would seem very strange to me that a monumental event such as the destruction of the temple and the end of the sacrificial system, which was so essential to Judaism, that would not be mentioned by somebody who was an author of the Holy Scriptures.
Yeah, that is a very good logical argument, and it is something, of course, that is used in order to make that case. And so the book of Revelation does have these hints in it as to when it was written. Of course, the book itself, you know, starts off and says that these things must shortly take place. In the very first verse, it says, for the time is near. The end, the last chapter says the same thing, and it seems rather curious if the events of the book of Revelation have not been fulfilled yet, then why are these time texts mentioned so clearly in the very first chapter, very first verse, and in the last chapter as well? And so the best book on this is Ken Gentry's book, Before Jerusalem Fell.
Mm-hmm.
It was a doctoral dissertation where he deals with the early late date controversy. And then he has another book which kind of updates some of those arguments in a less academic format in a book called The Beast of Revelation.
Well, I find it interesting that a lot of people with whom I share this view seem so sad and disappointed that we don't have a specific antichrist or beast to look forward to in our day.
Yeah, it is kind of funny to listen to them when you tell them this, but I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that they see the mess that the world is in. You know, you see the state of politics today and economics and what's going on in terms of international events and the rise of Islam, which, by the way, if you study the history of Bible prophecy, you will find that there is nothing unusual going on today that hasn't gone on centuries ago. And if we had time, we could go through all of that. The rise of Islam, place of Russia in Bible prophecy. I mean, you can go back and back and back, and you can find the same types of arguments that are being used today.
Mm-hmm.
But what you find today that's different is they hold to this idea, yeah, the world's going to get worse and worse. There's nothing we can do about it, so I'm not really responsible. And anyway, I'm going to be raptured out of here before it all takes place.
Mm-hmm.
So when you start messing with their eschatology and saying this whole scenario is not taught in Scripture, then they begin to figure out, uh-oh, I'm going to be left here, so the mess the world is in is, to a certain extent, my responsibility to bring about change to fix. And I thought, well, I wasn't going to be here to be responsible for that.
Yes, that is interesting. If you'd like to join us on the air with a question for Gary DeMar, whether you agree with what he is saying or whether you radically oppose what he is saying, or perhaps this is just something that you've never heard before and you're not sure, our number is 631-321-WNYG, 631-321-WNYG. We promise we will respect you no matter what eschatological view you may have. And we look forward to hearing from you. 631-321-WNYG, 631-321-WNYG. And as always, if you feel more comfortable remaining anonymous, you may do so. 631-321-WNYG. We'll be right back. Welcome back. This is Chris Sorensen, and our guest today, if you've just tuned us in, is Gary DeMar. He's an author, a Christian apologist, and president of American Vision, in addition to being editor-in-chief of Biblical Worldview. And today we are discussing the Beast of Revelation and the Antichrist, as well as the False Prophet, the Whore of Babylon, and other terms that we seek to identify today. And before we go back into the discussion, Gary, tell our listeners something about American Vision, if this is the first time they're hearing you interviewed, and also Biblical Worldview Magazine.
Well, American Vision has been around about 30 years, and we deal with worldview issues, prophecy being one of them, but we deal with issues related to, I wrote a series called God and Government, written some history, textbooks, America's Christian History, The Untold Story, Thinking Straight in a Crooked World, which is designed for high school kids as they go off to college. So we're kind of a mix of Christian apologetics, Christian worldview, America's Christian history. The eschatological thing is important because a lot of people said, why bother with the world in which we live? Because we're living the last days, and that was something I had to deal with in my worldview thinking. And if anybody is interested in what we do and what we offer, you can go to AmericanVision.org, AmericanVision.org, and there are books on there related to this topic as well as other topics.
Mm-hmm. And the Biblical Worldview magazine is both a literal magazine and an online source.
Right. It's about a 32-page magazine, comes out every other month, and it has a variety of articles in it on worldview issues, movie reviews, a contemporary movie review, as well as a classic movie review, which I do. We do seminars and debates and host conferences and things of that sort as well.
Going back to the Beast of Revelation, if I'm not mistaken, you said that Nero is the most probable candidate for that title?
Yes, and the reason for that is that the way it works is the fact that if the Revelation was written when the early daters say it was written, they would have put it smack dab in the middle of, I won't say the middle, but later in Nero's reign. He would be the sixth king that was alive while the Revelation was being revealed to John. Plus, his name, when put into Hebrew letters, which a Jew probably would have done or at least tried, it comes out to, if you spell it one way, 666, and that is the mark. That is the number. The number is not three sixes. The number is 600. Mm-hmm. Three Greek letters that are used, representing the number 600, representing the number 60, and then representing the number 6. So it's 666. And there's an interesting textual variant in some of the manuscripts that has the number of the beast as 616, and that would fit the Latinized spelling of his name with the final noon off of the Hebrew. Instead of Nero Caesar, Nero Caesar, it would be Neron Caesar would be 666, and then Nero Caesar would be 616. So that's the way that argument works.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is also possibly the, that would get too complicated, but that's essentially how the Nero is identified as the beast, the sea beast of Revelation 13.
Now, I have heard some very sick and twisted stories about Nero, that he actually had the nickname of being the beast in his day, because he, he used to dress in animal skins, and I heard that he would crawl up to Christians who were tied to stakes and actually chew off their genitals. And I apologize to our listeners for being so gruesome, but isn't that exactly what he used to do, among other things?
There's no doubt he was a nasty, nasty guy. We always hear about Caligula as being a bad guy, but Nero was a nasty, nasty guy, and he was a persecutor of the church. There really isn't much history that, as far as I've been able to tell, about Domitian in AD 95. Nero was the real bad guy. I mean, he persecuted Christians on a very regular basis, and you have to also understand at the time that there were still the Jews, and again, not all the Jews, because the early church was made up primarily of Jews, but there were those who opposed the church, and we have to remember that it was the Jews who really pressured Pilate to get rid of Jesus. And in the book of Acts, you will see how the Jews went against the church, and Rome early on really kept the Jews at bay over the church. But when Nero comes along, that all changes, and there begins to be an attack on the church. And so the historical situation fits the character of Nero, the number 666, the idea that the sixth king is still alive when Revelation is written, the time texts near and shortly and quickly and so forth. It does, in fact, fit Nero as being the beast of Revelation 13.
Mm-hmm. And why do you think John the Revelator used such cryptic language in the book of Revelation, and why he wasn't just speaking plainly about who the beast was, why using the number 666 and other things like that?
I think part of it is that we don't read the Bible the way a Jew would have read the Bible. In this class I'm teaching on Daniel, the point I made to the class was you read the book of Daniel, and when Daniel's giving these various visions about Nebuchadnezzar's dream of the metals, and they would immediately say, well, I've heard about those metals before, they make up the sanctuary. And then when they heard about these beasts and said, well, I know what the Bible says about beasts, about being dominated by beasts, which is a sign of judgment. You read when they read the Old Testament, they understood it completely. I won't say completely, but they understood the language because they had read it before. Revelation is really written against the backdrop of the Old Testament. And because of the time texts and the language from the Old Testament, there's a mention of Jezebel in there and Balaam and Egypt and Sodom, and you get these, Babylon is mentioned as well. They understood what was going on, even though they might not have gotten the particulars. Some have said, of course, it was designed, if it's ever got in the hands of Nero, that he would know exactly what was going on, but that's more speculative. I just think that those who read the Old Testament understood the book of Revelation better than we do. They wouldn't have seen Cobra helicopters or a Chinese army of 200 million men riding off into Israel. That's not the way they would have looked at the book of Revelation.
Mm-hmm. Another bizarre story I've heard about Nero is that after the death of his wife, he actually kidnapped a young boy and had him surgically altered as best as they could in that day and age to become a woman, and he married the boy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He was a very, very bad man, as Babu and Seinfeld would say. Very, very bad man. And Ken Gentry's book, The Beast of Revelation, has several chapters in it on Nero and his character, and he was really terrible.
So all these stories that we hear primarily from dispensationalists about the mark of the beast is really either a credit card or a tattoo that folks are going to be getting in the future, or perhaps even a computer chip implanted in their skin. I mean, there are some things that I've read in the media that you can understand why some Christians would be very nervous. I've even read that there's a company working on putting a computer chip that would act as a barcode type of scanning device that when you went to purchase things in a store, you wouldn't even need to go up to a register. You'd just be passing by something, and because this thing was implanted in your skin, the register would automatically ring up to what you owed, etc. But that has nothing to do with the Beast of Revelation.
Yeah, this is the thing. You don't have to hold to a particular prophetic position to understand that kind of stuff is sinister.
Yeah.
That's the point I try to make to people. It's just common sense that those kinds of things are bad. The very fact that language is used in Scripture to make that kind of case, I always use the case of 1 Samuel chapter 8,
mm-hmm.
where the people are told how bad this king is going to be, and they go and vote for him anyway. Well, that isn't prophecy. That's just a basic principle of Scripture that can be applied to any period of time. And we do that through the Bible constantly. We find things in Scripture, Judges chapter 9, where you find the best men, when given the chance to rule and to reign in power, decide not to do it, and they turn it over to the bramble, to the worst people in society. You don't have to be part of any particular prophetic situation to know that isn't the right thing to do. Anybody can look at what's going on in our culture today and say this is wrong. You don't have to tie it to a particular prophetic verse in order to make your case. What the prophetic verse does, of course, it tells us this has been done before and it can be done again. But although what I think was happening in Revelation chapter 13 is not what is happening today, I think this was dealing specifically with that particular period of time, with a particular set of events and particular people in mind.
And we have to go to a break right now. If you'd like to join us on the air with a question for Gary tomorrow, our number is 631-321-WNYG. 631-321-WNYG. We invite anyone, no matter what your eschatological view is, to join us on the air, even if you radically oppose what Gary is saying. Or if you agree, or you're just not certain. 631-321-WNYG. Well, don't go away. We'll be right back after these messages. Welcome back. This is Chris Aronson. We are interviewing Gary DeMar, author, Christian apologist, president of American Vision, and editor-in-chief of Biblical Worldview magazine. We're talking about the beast of Revelation and the Antichrist. Is the false prophet a term that is synonymous with the beast?
I think the false prophet is probably related more to Israel. Again, I think the false prophet idea is a religious figure more so than a political figure. And a prophet comes out of, in biblical terms, a prophet comes out of the nation of Israel. And so a false prophet, I think, should be identified more with Israel. I think that's why you see what's going on here is this collusion between Rome and apostate Israel against the work of Christ, because in the very next chapter, you got these two beasts in Revelation 13, and the very next chapter says, "And I looked, and behold, the Lamb was standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his name and the name of his father written on their foreheads." Now, this shows us mm-hmm. that there is a distinction here between beasts and lambs. They're different qualities, they're different entities. Plus, also, this goes to show us that this isn't dealing with something modern, because why in chapter 13 would this have to do with, you know, barcodes and implants and so forth? But the same language is used here about the Lamb who has the name of his father written on their foreheads. So whatever this written on their foreheads is all about, it's got to be of the same quality and character. And are we saying then that Jesus is going to mark us with a barcode and a you know, some sort of implant? We would say absolutely not. You have to understand these passages in terms of the time in which they were written and the time that they were written for.
So you're basically saying these are just figurative phrases.
These are sign symbols, and in fact, that's how Revelation starts. It uses the word that is and elsewhere in Scripture that these are signs, and they are visual signs that have real meaning behind them, but they are put together in terms of symbols that, you know, anyone could understand. You got Revelation chapter 12, where you have this woman. I grew up Roman Catholic, and in Roman Catholic Church, this was always the, you know, Mary standing on the moon and the stars, 12 stars on her head, and clothed with the sun. But it's obvious that this is a reference, you know, to Israel, depicted as a woman, mm-hmm. because in Genesis chapter 37, Israel is described as sun, moon, and stars.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there isn't a giant woman out there in space somewhere standing on the moon. And I don't think that's what this is all about. Then you have to move from there to the fact that another sign, see, it says, "And another sign appeared in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his heads were 7 diadems, and his tail swept away a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth." See, this is sign language,
mm-hmm.
And that is how it's described in Scripture. So you have to understand these things in terms of this signage. And so the marking on the forehead and so forth, you have to go back to Ezekiel, you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and it's very evident that what's being identified here, this isn't something with barcodes and implanted, you know, microchips. And again, that's not to say that if someone wants to put a barcode on your forehead or put a microchip in you, that you should just take it because this dealt with a different period of time.
Yes, in fact, the Roman Catholics who would insist the woman that you mentioned in that imagery was Mary, they're actually, I think, shooting themselves in the foot because if they believe, and I I'm sure you agree they wrongfully and heretically believe that Mary was sinless, then why does she have pain giving birth when that is clearly a sign of sin, a curse of Eve in the garden?
Yeah, there are all kinds of course, problems with that. But I can still remember, if I can see that thing in my head right now, that statue of Mary, based, I didn't know at the time, was based upon Revelation chapter 12.
We're going to open up our phone lines now, if you'd like to join us. Our number is 631-321-WNYG, 631-321-WNYG, and we do already have a caller on the line, Jim in Massapequa, Long Island. Welcome to Iron Sharpens Iron.
Hey, Chris. Thank you for taking my call.
Hey, it's Pastor Jim Capo, Massapequa Church of
yes.
God. I recognize your voice, brother. It's always great to have you call in, and in fact, it's always great to have you as a guest or a co-host.
Oh, thank you. It's great to be with you, and it's been a great show. I have one question. I'll ask it, and then I have to hang up. I'll listen on the radio for the answer. It concerns the early dating of Revelation. If Revelation was written at the early date, and its prophecy is fulfilled, and Nero is the Antichrist, as you've been discussing, what then would you say is the what is the message of Revelation to us today, and the application of the book for the church today?
Excellent.
Yeah, that's a good question, because people always ask, they'll say, well, man, if this stuff has already been fulfilled, then what message is there for us? What application can we make today? And the very first thing I tell people is that, do you believe that the hundreds of prophecies in the Old Testament referring to the first coming of Christ have already been fulfilled? People say, well, yeah, I do. I said, does the death of Christ nearly 2,000 years ago have any impact on you today? And we say, well, of course. So just because some prophecy is fulfilled, or a whole series of prophecies are fulfilled, doesn't mean they don't have any application for us. I think there are a couple of things we can get out of all of this is first of all, that God is true to his word, and God says soon, shortly, and quickly. He means that. When God says that he was going to promise to destroy the temple within a generation, in fact, that did happen just like he said it would. And also, I think we see here is that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And here we have positive evidence that God is true to his word, that he does in fact judge in history. And even though things may be a mess today, like they were a mess in the first century, and we talk about homosexuality and so forth today, but it was going on in the first century. I mean, Paul writes about it in Romans chapter 1 and 1 Timothy chapter 1 and 1 Corinthians 6. We see all of these things that are going on today. We see that they're unique to us, and I think Revelation tells us these things are not unique to us. It happened in the past, and as Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, and just like Jannes and Jambres, these men will not make further progress, for their folly will be obvious to all. And what the book of Revelation calls us to be is faithful. And if we're not faithful, we will see this kind of prolonged extrusion of evil take place in our world.
And I thank you for calling, Jim. I know Jim already left us, but we would have been sending you a free genuine leather Bible, retailing for $64.99, but since you hung up already, Jim, we're not going to be doing that. I'm only kidding. Jim has already won one of our Bibles by calling in the past, so we only give those to first-time callers. But anyway, Gary, who is the, or what is the Whore of Babylon?
Well, there are generally, put them in my realm, two areas, two possible candidates. Of course, we talked earlier about the Westminster Confession of Faith and some of the other confessions. They saw the Whore of Babylon as being the Roman Catholic Church. The position that I hold, that the book of Revelation is written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70, some say that the Whore of Babylon is Rome, or the Whore of Babylon is actually Israel, apostate Israel. Those are generally the two positions for those who take an early date for the book of Revelation. And Jesus in Matthew chapter 24, when he talks about the sun, moon, and stars falling, he borrows that language from Genesis chapter 37, but he also borrows it from Isaiah chapter 13, where sun, moon, and stars refers to the fall of nations, explicitly refers to the destruction of Babylon, and that Jesus was identifying New Testament Israel, apostate Israel, as Babylon, very much like he does in the book of Revelation, identify Jerusalem as Sodom and Egypt. And so all of these Old Testament enemies of Israel are kind of wrapped up together, and this is now a depiction of what apostate Israel has become. And that's one of the reasons why the temple was destroyed, the sacrificial system was gone, because by then Israel had become apostate. And as a result, just like the high priest in the Old Testament would go in and look at a house, and if there was a leprosy on the house, that house had to be destroyed and burned. And that's exactly what happened to the temple in A.D. 70.
Now, some of my dispensationalist fundamentalist friends would accuse you of, by denying that the Pope is the Antichrist, excuse me, that you're being soft on the heresies of the Roman Catholic Church. Now, that's not true at all, is it?
No, I don't know how if a prophecy refers to something in the past, mm-hmm. that I'm obligated now to force myself to apply those prophecies of the Roman Catholic Church. I think the Roman Catholic Church needs to be dealt with in terms of Scripture. And again, I don't think it has to be. Their position is, if it isn't prophetic, it isn't scriptural.
Mm-hmm.
And my point has always been, it doesn't have to be prophetic in order to evaluate something scripturally. Islam is not, certainly isn't scriptural, and I don't think there's, of course, a lot of them would say, well, Islam is in the Bible too, but we can't deal with the Roman Catholic Church and its doctrines based just upon an appeal to Scripture. When I became a Christian, I came out of the Roman Catholic Church. No one ever made the link between Roman Catholicism and prophecy. They made the link by, well, the Bible says this about Mary. The Bible says this about sola scriptura. The Bible says this about the perpetual virginity of Mary. The Bible says this about good works and the relationship between works and faith. Do I have to attribute that to prophetic prophecy? I just can't just go to the book of James and go to these other places and make these evaluations based upon what Scripture has to say. I don't understand the logic of being soft on the Roman Catholic
right.
Church when there are so many Scriptures that deal with the Roman Catholic Church on just simply scriptural grounds without having to bring in prophecy.
Yes, and I think some of the fundamentalist apologists make a huge mistake by dwelling so much on their eschatological speculations that they miss the primary thing. They should be comparing the Gospel of Rome with the Gospel of Scriptures.
Yeah, which is, in fact, that was Paul's argument in Galatians. I mean, again, you all you have to do is go to the book of Galatians, make your case. Here Paul's dealing with the Judaizers and the Jews in general, and all you have to do is say, you apply those same arguments to the Roman Catholic Church, because the Roman Catholic Church, in one sense, is a... Well, it's a works religion, which was the same thing that Paul was dealing with in Galatians.
Mm-hmm.
And which indication in Galatians, there's hardly anything dealing with prophecy in the book of Galatians or Ephesians.
Yeah, we have to go to a break right now. This is your final opportunity. If you'd like to join us on the air with a question for Gary DeMar, our number is 631-321-WNYG. 631-321-WNYG. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Gary, the man of lawlessness.
Oh, the man of lawlessness. I don't have time for that. I have, in my book, Last Day's Madness, I have two very detailed chapters dealing with the man of lawlessness. The man of lawlessness was, and if you look at the passage, Paul was dealing with this, the concept that they had either heard or had gotten a letter from him that the day of the Lord had already taken place. It doesn't say the rapture or the second coming, but the day of the Lord. And I think what Paul's dealing with there is this: they had had this idea that the day of the Lord was the judgment that was going to come upon Jerusalem. He couldn't be talking about the rapture, and he couldn't be talking about the second coming, because how in the world would they have ever thought they had gotten a letter from Paul that either the so-called rapture or the second coming had taken place yet. Mm. Because you can, you wouldn't know that unless those events had taken place, and there's no way that Paul could have written a letter if they, in fact, had taken place. And secondly, everybody was still there. So Paul, I believe, is dealing with something else altogether. Paul also states in that passage that they knew what was restraining him now. So this restraint of this man of lawlessness was going on in their day. And I think it has to deal with the sanctuary, with the priesthood, and so forth. Because if you do the study of what took place in events leading up to the destruction of Jerusalem in A.D. 70, the priesthood was corrupt. There was bloodletting that took place in there. I mean, it was an awful, awful thing. The temple had, in fact, been desecrated by the Jews themselves. Mm-hmm. And even the high priest at that time had lamented
yes.
how sad everything, how the temple had fallen into disrepair as a result of all this.
Yeah, the Hellenist Jews sacrificed a pig, I believe, in the temple.
Well, that was bad. That was Antiochus Epiphanes back in the 2nd century B.C., about 173 or so B.C. But there's an allusion to all of that in Matthew chapter 24, verse 15.
By the way, what was the fulfillment of the image speaking in the temple?
That's in Revelation chapter 13, and there's a lot of indication that those kinds of things did in fact take place. That these talking statues, if you ever go to the History Channel and watch this ancient discoveries of a fellow named Heron of Alexandria, very interesting to see that there were these ideas that these religious statues were actually made to speak and move and do all kinds of things in the first century.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, Gary, as always, it was truly a fascinating discussion, and I look forward to having you back on the program very soon. And please give our listeners your contact information for American Vision.
AmericanVision.org. It's very simple, AmericanVision.org.
Great. Well, God bless you, brother.
Right.
And
thank you, Chris.
Thank you so much for blessing me and our listeners with a truly fascinating discussion.